This is the road down which Russia's war of annihilation may lurch. And its emptiness speaks only of what is to come, from Russian-held Kherson up here to the vital port of Mykolaiv. They know what it is to be in Russia's way. Out of 18 homes, 10 are left in our village, she says. No electricity, gas, water or heat. The only ones left are those who can't leave, another adds. They're young, edgy, guns raised, unsure who we are. Press written on our vests and our press cards slowly calms them down and they apologise. But this is not an army in full control of its destiny. The trenches are where the rockets land every night. Some are from Odessa, Moscow's eventual target here. Others from just down the road.
You're saying his house is just over there?
It's important to see what tools Ukraine has been left with by a world that seems so concerned. They fight for their homes, but tell me they captured Russians who seemed unaware why they were even here. They said they can't understand what's going on. He said they can't go back because back there they're being shot for retreating, so they advance or surrender. Dust in Mykolaiv has sounded this way for weeks. But unbroken morale takes different forms. And this is a police chief driving a birthday gift to the governor with a captured Russian machine gun soldered onto it. It does not distract from the seriousness of the twilight world in which his colleagues work. Any drunk or man changing his car battery after curfew could be a Russian saboteur, they fear. There really is no way to check by looking at phones and in trunks. The city is dark, bar their lights and the flash of the distant enemy's bombs. An urgent hospital call for blood has gone out. They rush to help. The savagery of Russia's targeting measurable in how dark this four-floor hospital keeps itself at night. Invisible, not from a power cut, but to avoid Russian bombs. Mykolaiv has been fearing encirclement for days. There is heartbreak for those who leave. Amid the shared agony, still a tussle to get on to buses to Moldova. The men stay.
Yes, this is my wife, Xenia, and my daughter, Varvara.
And she goes to Poland.
She goes to Poland. After come back.
And what will you do?
So I go to the... This is my country. What I must do? Go to the Poland? No Poland. This is my home.
Стойте, пожалуйста.
And there is heartbreak for those who stay. Svetlana lost her husband in a rocket attack Sunday that killed 9 outside a shop. The violence here is a chain of moments of blinding grief.
И мужа моего просто разорвало. Он захлебнулся кровью. Он в крови, в луже крови лежит до сих пор там еще. Он лежит там. А меня забрали. И осколки.
Pieces left.
Ракету кинули.
To wander alone. Nick Paton Walsh, CNN, Mykolaiv, Ukraine.
Peter Zalmayev is the director of the Eurasia Democracy Initiative, and he joins me now from near Kyiv. Thanks for being with us. You're staying in the country. You've told our producers you have no intention of leaving. What's morale like right now among Ukrainians near the capital?
Well, this is what you heard in the previous segment. The boys say, you know, I don't want to go to Poland. This is my country. As brutal and as barbaric as the bombardment of Ukrainian cities has been, there's no question in Ukrainians' minds that what they're fighting for. They're fighting for their home. They're fighting for their future. They absolutely reject any idea that Russia will be imposing its own system, you know, its philosophy of life and governance on Ukraine. If there was ever a doubt about Ukrainians' identity, about Ukrainians willing to live in a liberal democracy, those doubts have disappeared once, you know, Russian tanks started crossing the Ukrainian border on the, you know, morning of February 24th.
But you must have some concern for your family's safety. But despite that, and I'm hearing that from many Ukrainians, by the way, that we're talking to here in the western part of the country, I guess your position is, this is my country and I have no intention of becoming a refugee, because you're an American Ukrainian. So you could legally leave, but you're choosing not to.
No, I'm choosing not to. Obviously, this is the place to be. You know, right now, Vladimir Putin is trying to, he said he was trying to impose control over all of Ukraine when he talked to President Macron and Erdogan of Turkey. I don't think he has the forces to do that, but he certainly has the forces to keep terrorizing the whole country. It's a calculated risk, obviously, you know, for me to remain in Ukraine. But I believe that, you know, Ukraine shall prevail. I have no doubt in my mind, and there will be a lot of need, you know, for folks like me to try to, you know, bring it up to speed, to try to start, you know, rebuilding Ukraine, to try to bring back the millions of Ukrainians that have left. You know, it's estimated that already the Ukraine has suffered close to $100 billion of damage. Much more is expected, obviously, as Vladimir Putin escalates his campaign of terror. You know, he is clear that he has suffered significant setbacks on on the fields, in military-wise. He has no plan, really. Mm-hmm. His only plan is to keep terrorizing civilians, to try to bring Ukrainians to their knees.
Right, but that's not going to be enough to take over the country, to continue to occupy it. What do you see as a possible off-ramp for Putin's military here? Because where is a potential exit here? If Vladimir Putin at some point realizes, because some people say he's maybe even a bit delusional about his army's advances in Ukraine, but at some point, what if he realizes this is not a fight that he can win militarily? Where is the diplomatic open door? How do you force, what does that look like potentially?
Well, everyone is questioning, you know, and asking that question. I think that we will not be able to see that off ramp for as long as Vladimir Putin thinks that he will, his actions in Ukraine will go unpunished. You have to be obviously sending the right signals. Mr. Zelensky, the Ukrainian president, has already done so. He has declared his willingness to consider neutrality status for Ukraine, to consider saying no to NATO plans. This is ostensibly Vladimir Putin's demands, even though I don't believe that's really been the case. It's the NATO expansion thing is more of a red herring for Vladimir Putin, and this is a war of conquest for him. But the Ukrainian side is definitely trying to claim the initiative in this process. Zelensky will be addressing members of Congress. So while he's sending these signals diplomatically that he's willing to sit down and actually offer Mr. Putin an off-ramp, without a muscular show of strength, Vladimir Putin will not sit down. So we're talking about bolstering Ukraine's defenses, which include possibly providing Ukraine with Russian-made surface-to-air missile defense systems, since Washington has pretty much ruled out Ukraine's request to close the airspace. So that is the next step, the next best option that Washington must do to help Ukraine.